From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. I'm Susan Vita, the Chief of the Music Division, and I'd like to welcome you to today's lecture by Dr. Kendra Preston Leonard, the next in a series of lectures which we are proud to co-sponsor with the American Musicological Society. We hope that these lectures will not only demonstrate the rich variety of materials found in our collection, but also to inspire musicologists to visit the library and explore these materials. I welcome all of you in the audience this afternoon, as well as those of you who will watch the webcast of this lecture on the Library of Congress website. Music Division staff always look forward to the AMS lectures and the opportunity to see old friends who have frequented the Performing Arts Reading Room and learn about where their research took them after they left the library. Today we are happy to welcome Dr. Kendra Preston Leonard, who will present on myth and meaning in Louise Talma's first period works. Dr. Leonard is the author of the forthcoming book, Louise Talma, A Life in Composition, which will be published by Ashgate in 2014. The Music Division is home to the Louise Talma papers, an archival collection that documents the career of the composer, pianist, and educator through manuscript and published scores, sketches, correspondence, programs, clippings, and photographs. Before we begin, however, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Anne Walters Robertson, Claire Du Swift Distinguished Service Professor of Music at the University of Chicago, who will offer greetings from AMS Society.
Yes, welcome everyone. It's a pleasure once again to be in Coolidge Auditorium for a presentation by a member of the American Musicological Society. We're deeply grateful, as always, that the Library of Congress and its Music Division continue to welcome our scholars into these remarkable collections and to provide such a lovely venue for our colleagues to present the fruits of their research with the public. Our speaker today is Kendra Preston Leonard, a scholar-performer who has recently made intriguing discoveries on the career of one of America's greatest compositional talents of the 20th century, Louise Talma. Kendra Leonard studied musicology at the Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music, and she received her training in cello performance at Peabody Conservatory, the Guildhall School in London, and the University of Miami. Ms. Leonard has taught at Westminster Choir College of Rider University. She lives in Loveland, Ohio, where she works in music publishing and editing at the Music Word Media Group. She's also managing editor of the Journal of Music History Pedagogy. Among her many honors, Kendra has held grants and fellowships from the Beinecke Rare Book and Manuscript Library at Yale, the National Coalition of Independent Scholars, and the Hochschule Mozarteum in Salzburg. Ms. Leonard's exceptionally broad scholarship encompasses subjects ranging chronologically from the 16th to the 21st centuries, and topically from music for historical film and science fiction to the salon of famed French mentor of several generations of American composers, Nadia Boulanger. Her work has centered on the use of pre-existing music in films made from Hollywood to Bollywood, especially on the presence of Elizabethan and other English Renaissance musical influences in historical cinema, including the movies Richard III, Elizabeth I, Twelfth Night, Otello, and Romeo and Juliet. She's the author of many articles and of two important books, Shakespeare, Madness and Music, Scoring Insanity and Cinematic Adaptations, and the Conservatoire Américain, A History, and Sue mentioned her forthcoming book on Louise Talma. In her talk today, Kendra will treat us to an outgrowth, then, of her research on the famous American Conservatory in Fontainebleau, France. She will offer us a revisionist view of the early career and works of Conservatoire alum Louise Talma, drawing on her extensive research here in the collections. Her lecture is entitled Meaning and Myth in Louise Talma's First Period Works. Please join me in welcoming Kendra Preston Leonard.
I'm honored to have been invited to speak here today, and I want to thank the AMS and the Library of Congress in giving me this opportunity to discuss the research I've done in the Library's Music Division. I would also like to thank Elizabeth Johnson Overman and Dave Foley, who have volunteered to perform here today as part of today's talk. These will be two world premieres of Louise Talma's early songs. I sometimes feel like my work is part of a subfield we could call Mythbusters, Musicology Edition. And I think this is true for many musicologists. We're always correcting the historical record, finding new evidence for hard facts about composers, performers, and works, and discovering new materials that help us interpret or understand those works more fully. We are, as a culture, drawn to stories of hard luck, long odds, and fantastic triumphs. Horatio Alger's stories about the journey from rags to riches, or fairy tales about challenges and rewards. So we like stories about prodigies, life-changing concerts, and other musical experiences, wise old teachers passing down their gifts, and have codified these so that every great, or even good musician, is expected to have at least one such story in his or her biography. Real life, however, is much less formulaic, and often much more interesting. After writing about Nadia Boulanger and her teaching at the Conservatoire Americain in Fontainebleau, France, I became interested in her students. Many of her male students are well known, their music and lives regularly studied. But I wanted to know about her female students. Boulanger regularly told women in her classes not to pursue serious careers as professional musicians, but a rare few received the opposite advice: go forth and compose. One of these was Louise Talma. Talma herself long claimed to have had one of those cinematic, it changed my life forever moments in studying with Boulanger. Talma attended the Conservatoire Americain for the first time in 1926 to study piano with Isidore Philippe, and Boulanger, her harmony instructor, suggested that she return the following year as a composition student instead. But as I began working my way through the Talma collection here and elsewhere, I discovered that this was, like Alger's stories, a well-crafted and compelling fiction told to distract questioners away from the truth and to provide them with a memorable tale that they sought, one in which Talma's mother gave up her own promising vocal career in order to devote herself to her more talented pianist daughter, and which credited the very popular Boulanger as the sole axis on which Talma's creative life as a composer turned. And so today I'll talk about two myths surrounding Talma, both of which she herself fostered throughout her career. The first myth holds that Talma's father, a musician, died when Louise was young, that her mother, Cecile, gave up her career to teach her only child. The second myth maintains that Talma's interest in composition began only after being encouraged to do so by Boulanger, and that Boulanger was the arbiter of Talma's early professional and compositional musical tastes. These erroneous elements of Talma's biography have proliferated in the standard sources about her life and works. Talma was notably reluctant to discuss her childhood and early adult life and actively discouraged interviewers and friends from asking about it, even supplying them with inconsistent and incomplete information, deliberately omitting details and facts. However, as I have demonstrated elsewhere, there are numerous examples of autobiography in Talma's works. And because Talma's musical compositions are tied so closely to her life, it is essential to know the truth about her early history and composition career. Fortunately, recently discovered sources now allow for a preliminary reconstruction of a narrative of Talma's youth. These materials are revelatory, suggesting new explanations for several key events and decisions in Talma's life, as well as helping to illuminate her first compositions. What has been to date accepted and repeated without question about Talma's youth stems primarily from a 1954 account of her childhood by Madeline Goss, later repeated by other authors in several sources. Here's one from Susan Tyker. And here's another from Susan Ware in Notable American Women, a biographical dictionary. Almost none of the statements provided on these slides are true. Alma Cecile Garrigues, Talma's mother, was born in Copenhagen in 1872 to a Danish mother and a father descended from a French Huguenot family and came to New York when she was two. Sometime before 1900, Alma, as she was known to her family and in some legal documents, adopted the name Cecile Talma and was billed as Mademoiselle Cecile Talma from that time forward. Although it is unclear exactly when she changed her surname and why, it is possible that she wanted to hint at connections to the great French actor Joseph Talma, and may also have been borrowing and adapting the surname of relatives known as Talman or Talman. While I dislike the practice of calling female subjects by their first name in general, in order to distinguish between Cecile Talma and Louise Talma in this lecture, I'll refer to Cecile by her first name. Cecile, a soprano, performed in France in 1900 and began singing in Great Britain in 1903, where she received good reviews and was made the prima donna of her company. Despite this success, she returned to New York in September of 1904 to be an understudy at the Met for the 1904-05 season. However, what hopes she had for a career in America were dashed after receiving a poor reception at her debut performance with the Met later that year. Appearing as Netta in I Pagliacci, Cecile was criticized as inadequate, and the New York Times critic brusquely dismissed the idea of her career continuing with any success. Cecile toured with the Met the following year in the chorus, but dropped off the Met roles after 1905, save a single final performance in January of 1910. Her last public performances at all appear to have taken place in 1914 in South Carolina and New York. These two were critically panned. After these failures, Cecile made a living giving piano and voice lessons and may have worked as a music critic using a pseudonym. During the first decade of the century, Cecile was also supported at least in part by a benefactor named Walter Smith. Writing to Talma, Cecile's sister Edith stated that it was in Talma's best interest to know about her relationship with old man Smith. Smith provided Cecile with a monthly cash stipend and had paid for all of her vocal training, ballet classes, French lessons, diction lessons, clothes, travel, and housing costs for several years in the first two decades of the 20th century. Smith gave Cecile $100 a month plus the monthly interest on $90,000. And at some point, he settled a cash amount of $30,000 on her and ended all other support. It's not clear how long Smith provided Cecile with these funds or whether there were other similar benefactors. Talma herself may have been dedicated to rigorous financial self-sufficiency because she did not want to rely on money from others, which could be given or taken away without notice, as her mother had done. She provided some financial support for her own relatives and assisted students at times, but repeatedly turned down offers of what she felt was unearned money to offset professional expenses. Cecile's money may have been the basis for the more than accumulated savings of more than $1 million that Talma left to the McDowell colony at her death. What is clear is that it is unlikely that Cecile gave up her career for her daughter. She was simply not proficient enough for a career as a vocalist and found other means of support. The facts are also at odds with the idea that Cecile groomed Talma from the start for a career in music. Talma herself often stated at school she excelled not only in music, but in chemistry as well, and had considered a career in the sciences. And in fact, one early biography gives Talma degrees in chemistry, master's and bachelor's degrees, rather than the ones in music she actually had. After her stint at the Met, Cecile is next documented traveling from France and arriving in New York in August 6, 1906, and her marital status is left blank. Either she returned to France very soon afterwards to give birth to Louise, or she falsified the oft-provided information that Talma was born in Arcachon, France, on October 31st of that year. In the 1920 New York census, Talma is listed as being born in New York, while a different document records her birth date as October 7, 1905. Either date seems possible, especially in light of the fact that the Département of Gironde, where Arcachon is located, has no birth records for Talma, that Cecile provided inaccurate data for her own birth date as she aged, and that Cecile's father was an obstetrician who could easily have delivered his own grandchild in New York. For her part, Talma used the October 31, 1906 birth date throughout her life. Documents next show that in August of 1909, Cecile made an application for a United States passport for herself and a minor child to travel abroad. The application does not state the name or age of the child. Just 2 months later, Cecile and Talma traveled to the United States from France, arriving in New York at the end of October. Cecile gave her marital status as married and her age is 34. At some point, either together or separately, both Cecile and Talma returned to Europe. In 1913, they're listed as passengers on the ship Niagara, traveling from Le Havre to New York. This is where Talma's birth date is given as a year earlier, 1905. Cecile gave her marital status as divorced. Here you can see Talma, Cecile, and then underneath her child, Louise. The pair does not seem to have left the United States again until they traveled to France in 1926. The origins and identity of Talma's father are more difficult to trace. In several interviews, Talma identified her father as Frederick Talma, an American musician, and presumably she was told this by her mother. However, on Cecile's 1910 passport application, she writes that she is absolutely divorced from my husband, George Talma. Cecile's legal relationship with Talma's father is unknown. Until Talma was 12, Cecile maintained that the elusive Mr. Talma had died before Louise was born. She later claimed that they were divorced before Louise's birth, and in the 1920 United States Census, Cecile Talma listed herself as a widow. Sarah Dorsey and Anna Neal have suggested that Cecile was married in a shotgun wedding, but near the end of her life, Talma confided to a friend that she believed her parents had probably not married at all. Either of these latter circumstances would explain why Talma might have been born in an obscure resort town in France, if she was actually born there. Such health resort towns or spas often catered to women who needed abortions or who wished to give birth with no questions asked about their marital status or the identities of their newborn's fathers. While in France at the time, a single mother and her child may not have undergone much scrutiny or stigma, they would have in the United States, where births out of wedlock were still considered scandalous, especially among the upper classes to which the Garrigues belonged. In France, however, the 19th century had seen a rise in illegitimate births, and a French account contemporary with Talma's birth suggests that indifferent or even positive attitudes towards out-of-wedlock births and irregular or non-legalized relationships were common throughout the social strata. And in the middle upper classes in particular, such relationships were considered a sign of emancipation rather than immoral behavior. Nonetheless, French law at the time did not give an illegitimate child the right to discover the name of his or her father, and the father's name could only be put on a birth certificate if adultery was not involved. That is, if the father was married to another woman, the child's documentation could legally list that child's mother's name only. It is not certain whether Talma believed throughout her adult life that her parents had not been married, or whether she came to that conclusion over time. At one time, Talma maintained, at least to Nadia Boulanger, that her parents had been married, albeit briefly, writing that my mother and father were married in London, September 15, 1905. They separated the following summer, and that I was born October 31, 1906. However, there is no marriage record in either the English or Welsh Register Office for either the name Talma or Garrigues, and these records date well back into the 18th century. After their return to America in 1913, the Talmas are next found in the 1920 New York City census, dated January 14th and 15th. Cecile Talma is listed as having been born in Denmark, and that Danish is her first language. She gave her age as of 40, as of her last birthday, although according to her 1910 passport application, she would actually have been 44. And she's listed as the head of the household. She lists her primary occupation as teacher music. Louise is listed as 13 years old at the time of the census, which would put her birth date sometime late in 1906, and her first language is listed as French. But what is most intriguing about the 1920 census is a record of a second Talma daughter. Beneath Louise's name in the Talma family record, there is an entry for Laura Talma. Laura is recorded as having been born in New York and is listed at 10 years old at her last birthday, indicating that she would have been born sometime in late 1909, as existing documents make it clear that Cecile Talma traveled with Louise alone in October of 1909, and her last performance with the Met Chorus was in January of 1910. The space for Laura's first language is left blank. This empty space suggests that Laura was nonverbal, as even native speakers of English were listed as speaking that language in census forms. The nationality of the father of both girls is listed as French. Cecile states that Louise was born in New York and that Louise had entered the United States after being abroad in 1908, slightly earlier than what's listed by the passenger list of 1909. As for Laura's name, recently discovered documents show that one of Cecile's aunts, the famous soprano and vocal coach known professionally as Esperanza Garrigue, bore the first name of Laura. just as Louise and Louis's and Cecile's ran in the family, so it seems did Laura's. To date, there are no other available records on Laura Talma, and the identity of her father is impossible to ascertain. The 1930 census, taken in April, lists only Cecile and Louise Talma at the same address as the previous document. Cecile gave her age as 56, and Louise is listed as 23. Cecile is marked down as a widow, Louise is single, and they are both listed as music teachers. Cecile is a voice teacher, and Louise is a piano instructor. Cecile gives her age at the time of first marriage as 30. There are some other differences from the 1920 census as well. Louise's record now lists the nationality of her father as Russian and states that she was born in 1907. Cecile is listed as having immigrated to the United States in 1870 and Louise in 1913. And all of this gives us the following timeline. It is possible that Laura Talma could have been given up for adoption, sent away from New York, or placed in service. But since Cecile kept and raised Louise and still had Laura living with her when Laura was 10, adoption is unlikely. Nor is it likely that her mother and sister would have left her in the care of family or friends, disowned her, or otherwise have broken off all contact. Laura, nonverbal as the census indicates and possibly further disabled, may have been placed in an institution as she grew older and closer to puberty. The family may simply have left her in the care of the state. It is also possible that, whether living at home or in an institution, Laura died sometime between being counted in the 1920 census and the spring of 1926, when Cecile and Louise went to France together for the first time. I suspect that Laura Talma died either at home or in a care facility in the influenza pandemic that began in 1918 and claimed victims through 1922. The so-called Spanish flu killed between 500,000 and 675,000 Americans, particularly affecting those in highly populated cities, such as New York. Across New York, more than 33,000 people died from the flu between 1918 and 1922. Because of the scale of this pandemic, death records were not always filled out or filed. Where they do exist, they are often incomplete and contain spelling and other errors. This history presents several complicated scenarios regarding the birth of Laura and the whereabouts of Louise Talma between her birth and 1913. In brief, Talma's own memories and historical records suggest that Louise lived in Europe from 1906 to 1909, and again from 1909 or 1910 to 1913. She remembered having spoken German, Italian, and French at home, as well as English, when she was a young child, but never Danish, her mother's native language. And she remembered playing Butterfly's Baby in opera productions starring her mother's friend Cornelia Fabricotti, and a typical early French education at the time followed this. Fabricotti only performed the role in the 1911 to 1912 season in Florence, and since there are no records of Cecile having performed the role, Talma's recollection of speaking Italian and French at home would presumably refer to this childhood stay with Fabricotti. The question as to why Cecile gave her daughter to friends to raise for several years is perhaps explained by evidence of Laura's birth in 1909. The implications of these findings are significant. The short life and early death of a younger sister may well explain a number of events and choices in Louise Talma's life. Laura could clearly not have been kept a secret to those who knew the Talmas during this period, but her obvious illegitimacy and probable disability may have been a factor in Louise Talma's later insistence on privacy regarding her personal life and her strong disinclination as an adult to discuss her childhood and family. Laura's death, which had to have occurred between January 1920 and the spring of 1926, could also have been the impetus for the two surviving Talma women to immerse themselves in music studies anew at the Conservatoire Americain. By this time, Louise Talma was already well on her way to a career as a concert pianist and teacher. She had attended the Institute of Musical Art, which later became the Juilliard School. She had given her first public New York recital in March of 1925. She was teaching theory at the neighborhood music school and piano privately. Undertaking a new course of study, particularly as one as involved and as expensive as that of the Conservatoire Americain, was a rather drastic move for both women. Nonetheless, for the next 5 years, they traveled together every summer for 3 months of intense study at Fontainebleau. Laura's death may also have encouraged Talma's desire to bond with and emulate Nadia Boulanger, who also lost his younger sister early in life. Following her sister Lily's early death from Crohn's disease at age 24, Boulanger devoted herself to preserving Lily's memory and promoting her works. Although Talma never made specific references to her sister in any correspondence with Boulanger, she may well have felt a closeness with her, in part because of this commonality. Certainly, Talma tried to draw other parallels between Boulanger and herself throughout their long relationship, variously linking their French origins, the musical backgrounds of their families, and early musical training and career ambitions, Talma's nursing of her mother during her last illness and Boulanger's similar caregiving experiences, and Talma's struggle working as a teacher when, like Boulanger in her early years, she desired to work as a composer. Laura's death could also have been a previously unseen factor in Talma's religious questioning and ultimately her conversion to Roman Catholicism as an adult. Raised a Protestant, probably of the Lutheran variety, Talma professed herself to be an agnostic in her early 20s. Her sister's early death may have caused her to first reject religion and then perhaps to look for answers and comfort in it. If this is the case, Boulanger capitalized on Talma's spiritual searching by leading her to Catholicism without ever knowing one of Talma's underlying reasons for returning to belief. Most importantly, Laura's death may have directly influenced Talma's first musical compositions. These works, mostly songs for female voice and piano, uniformly express loss and mourning. Talma began studying composition seriously with Harold Brockway and Percy Goodschuss at the Institute of Musical Art well before traveling to France and meeting Boulanger. While previous scholarship on Talma asserts that her early style, in particular, owes everything to Boulanger's influence, these songs refute this claim by showing that Talma was already working in a style compatible with the French neoclassic aesthetic favored by Boulanger before she became Boulanger's composition pupil. Talma's earliest extant works date from 1925 and provide a glimpse of her first compositional impulses. These impulses include, in some cases, the use of elements that would return as Talma began to develop her own mature voice as a composer in the late 1930s. These pieces illustrate her early use of common neoclassic tropes, including small performing forces and transparent textures, the use of counterpoint and an emphasis on rhythm, extended or otherwise non-traditional harmony, and the presence of the grand ligne, a long melodic line that gives structure to a work. Talma's four earliest songs for soprano and piano are located in the Louise Talma collection here at the Library of Congress. They have not yet been published, although they may have been the works that won Talma the Institute of Musical Arts Seligman Prize in 1927, 28, and 29. Today I'll focus on two of these, On the Surface of Things from 1926 and Song in the Songless from 1928. This first work sets Wallace Stevens's poem On the Surface of Things, which, like many of the texts Talma used during this period, uses imagery and color to evoke natural elements and a sense of melancholy and loss. Talma would return to Stevens' poems throughout her career, setting many of those that appeared in his first volume of poetry. Stevens divides his poem into three sections, indicated in Talma's setting by the change of pitches in the left hand. Talma's setting of On the Surface of Things is often tonally ambiguous. She frequently uses the descending minor or major second, often known as the sigh motif, to indicate sorrow and suffering in a number of her works. She uses the minor second here melodically in the vocal line, while positioning the melody against the accompaniment in such a way as to create harmonic tritones and major sevenths. The song, which has no key signature, has four distinct harmonic sections. Talma establishes in this song what I term discontinuity, in which she maintains consistent elements while disrupting these with new materials. She uses this to structure her works pretty much from beginning to end. There is always an element that is continuous from one section to the next, though this may be disrupted by other elements and returns later on. The four sections of On the Surface maintain a static rhythmic quality while shifting pitches in close movement. Part one, in which the pitches are A, B, and E, sets the text of the first stanza. Part two sets the second stanza and is marked by a shift to G, C, and D. Part three begins with the second half of measure 25 and sees a shift from the piano's pattern of a perfect fourth above a major second to chordal stacks of pitches. Part three sets the last two lines of Stevens's section three, and the final line of the poem is set by itself as part four in a stack of E flat, B flat, and F. Although Talma was not consciously working with serial techniques at this point in her career, all of the trichords she uses here are transpositions of prime form 0 to 7, and this presages her adoption of serialism in 1952. Each block or section of the song suggests multiple key centers, employing axial centricity in which selected pitches function in various ways. The melodic line, a canon in which the piano first states the line and the voice enters 10 beats later, adds to the sense of uncertainty through the use of melodic major sevenths and minor seconds that do not resolve in a traditional manner. In part one, the piano suggests tonal centers of both E minor and A minor, moving more firmly into A major with the introduction of F sharp and G sharp, leading to A at the beginning of the second phrase. This centering on A is short-lived, however, and by the beginning of the second phrase, Talma has modulated into an area outlining C minor and G minor. By the end of part three, Talma changes the focus again in the left hand from the centers of G and C to chordal chords, stacking pitches together under a melodic line that cadences on E and then A. Part four places E flat, B flat, and F in the left hand. Talma assigns a variation on the song's opening to the right hand and then to the voice using D sharp in the melody, which suggests again a center of E but does not resolve to it. The voice cadences with a drop of a fourth from A to E while the piano continues to sustain E flat, B flat, and F, emphasizing the minor second common to the song's first harmonic section while repeating the tritone of its second half. Taken as a whole, the song is plaintive and a little raw. The motion of the voice against static accompaniments is restless, and the voice seems to seek a tonal home while wondering at the instability and beauty of the surrounding sonic world. This song is Talma's first work in which the counterpoint helps drive the piece, and from this point forward, contrapuntal writing regularly occurs in her works. The canon in On the Surface is simple. For each of the nine lines of poetry, the right hand of the piano states the vocal line 10 beats before the voice enters in canon. The consistency with which the canon's entries occur first creates and then fulfills the expectation that the voice will imitate the piano line with each entrance, while the distance of 10 beats between the piano and vocal entrances removes any sense of metric stability indicated by the song's regular and unchanging 6/4 meter. Ties and slurs frequently group notes into irregular cells of 5 and 7 beats, further obscuring the work's meter and creating elements of discontinuity that more accurately reflect the text's metrical constructions. While the left hand has steady dotted half notes, its static quality and perpetual dynamics of piano relegate it more to a color than a keeper of time. On the Surface, which contains a number of similarities to Talma's first extant work, Invocation to the Rain, presents a study of contrasts and emotion conducted through the language of color and place. The golden images are covered with blue ones, the world becomes less stable and more unknown, nature darkens the skies and drenches the fields and hides the light of the moon. The effect is that of drawing a mourning veil over a previous happiness and sense of joy. This represents a changed worldview, the recognition that there is a missing element from the established order of life, and speaks poignantly to this loss through the selection of text and the use of common musical markers of sadness and grief. We'll have a performance of this.
Thank you.
Setting a text by English poet George Meredith, the manuscript of Song and the Songless has no key signature or meter and is unbarred save for a single bar line after the first two lines of text, about one quarter of the way through the piece. When I talk about it here today, though, I'll refer to measure numbers in the performing edition that Liz and Dave are using. The score notes that accidentals hold only for the notes in front of which they are placed, and the tempo is a dirge-like quarter note equals 46. However, as with On the Surface, Talma creates a different section for each stanza, in this case, four distinct parts of two lines each. Talma's choice of the song may well reflect Laura's existence, particularly her nonverbal status and Talma's desire to speak for her as well as of her. Song, like On the Surface, also frequently uses the minor second and tritone both melodically and harmonically. The song begins with an introductory section of stacked thirds moving in contrary motion between two hands in a palindromic progression over seven beats. This harmonic symmetry is replicated throughout the piece, particularly at the beginning of the final section, which is an introduction to the last two lines. Texturally, the accompaniment for the first and last stanzas is identical. Stanza two is slightly more syncopated, and the third stanza is supported by counterpoint over a pedal point. The palindromes create a sense of continuity and parallelism between the song's beginning and end, and the pedal point present during the contrapuntal section grounds the song even as unexpected variations on the vocal motif of 3/8 and a quarter note propel the work towards the return of the palindrome just prior to the final stanza. Tonal centers are created by the use of the ascending melodic second, with pitches functioning as scale degrees 7/1 in the vocal line at four cadential points. These cadences are also created by the repetition of scale degree 1 pitch and by the pause of the vocal line after the repetitions. Talma emphasizes the relationship of the fifth between the song's tonal centers by beginning the first and last sections with an open fifth in the piano from A to D. The second section uses the open fifth as well as the tritone in the harmony, providing continuity while subtly destabilizing the expectation of the interval's consistency. The third section continues the use of the tritone and the minor second while also varying the vocal motif in the piano part and introducing clusters of minor thirds. The result is a highly chromatic harmonic language that Talma would use frequently in her works prior to her adoption of serial techniques in the 1950s. And we'll hear that now. Songs demonstrate the growth of her ability and confidence in songwriting from the simple block chords and melodies that appear in her very first song to the more complex song that we just heard. The works that immediately follow this, including her three madrigals of 1929, are not nearly as harmonically wide-ranging or experimental in any sense, in part because she was asked to return to more conventional common practice periods by approaches by Boulanger. The characteristic displayed in her four early songs, however, including the pattern of discontinuity in the harmonic and rhythmic elements, rapidly changing tonal and axial centers and moods, meticulous text setting, and an openness of form, all foreshadow Talma's more vocal, more mature vocal compositions. The development seen in these early songs suggests that Talma might have moved in a more radical way away from tonality and convention had her training taken a different route. By the time she composed Song and the Songless, she had abandoned traditional key and time signatures. However, her experimentation stops there for a time. When Talma began formally studying composition with Boulanger in 1927, her notebooks for harmony, solfège, and composition lessons at the Conservatoire Américain, which date from 1928 to 1932, show that she was focused on functional tonality and mastering common practice period harmony through counterpoint, dictation, and other exercises. Her return to basics, along with the emphasis that Boulanger gave to Monteverdi, Bach, and Beethoven during this period, seems to have strongly affected Talma's own compositional voice for several years. Her works immediately following these songs were quite different from the freedom of Song and the Songless. Isabeau Poème, an instrumental work composed between 1927 and 1928, and the 1929 three madrigals, the beginning of which you see here, are strictly traditional. They broke no ambiguities in key, are rhythmically staid, and have conventionally phrased and structured melodies. They did win prizes, but they're definitely not as original as her earlier works. It is worth mentioning the text that Talma chose for her chamber work, Isabeau Poème, which was written for a Canadian Pacific Railways composition contest. The piece uses several French and French-Canadian folk songs as its basis, and although it was composed during the time in which Boulanger began teaching Talma, its death and sadness-centered text connect it more with Talma's first songs than the other works that she produced during the 1920s and early 1930s. Isabeau Poème is based primarily on a few folk songs in particular. It's not clear how Talma chose the songs for the piece. Alouette, of course, is a traditional children's song, introducing the names for the parts of the body as the narrator prepares to pluck them from the lark. Isabeau itself has two sets of text, both sad love songs. In one, a young woman is wooed by a sailor singing on his ship. When she joins him to learn the song, she finds that she has lost a golden ring. He dives for it and drowns. In the other version, the woman hears the sailor singing and cries because her own heart is inconstant, and while she gives it away repeatedly, it is always broken. La Belle Françoise is about the sorrow of a young woman who cannot marry her beau before he is sent to war. Sept ans sur mer is a sea chanty in which sailors lost at sea for 7 years are hallucinating about beautiful women as they lie starving, having eaten all of the ship's stores, mice, and rats, and are drawing lots to see which sailor will be eaten first by his crewmates. In Le Miracle de Nouvelle-Née, a mother casts her illegitimate baby out to sea, but as the child drowns, its soul ascends to heaven. And in La Belge Muette, the last of the songs used, we are told the story of a shepherdess to whom the Virgin Mary appears. As yet, I have not found anything in Talma's notes or correspondence that might hint at the reasons behind these rather morbid and macabre stories, but Occam's Razor suggests that she selected all of the songs in the work because of their connection to Canada. Nonetheless, they are melancholy, and it is possible that in selecting children's songs and sad ballads, Talma was again expressing sadness for the early death of her sister Laura. We will never know the identity of Louise and Laura's fathers. We will never know when, where, and how Laura and Talma died. And we'll probably never know the full impact that her life and death had on Cecile and Louise Talma. It is understandable that Talma, in recognizing the social attitude surrounding divorce and illegitimacy, would have kept to a single family mythos in order to protect her mother's reputation and later her own. But ultimately, what we find in uncovering these myths of Talma's early life are great sorrows and a desire for independence, both of which led to the beginning of an exceptional career. Thank you.
mentioned that Nadia Boulanger did not encourage the, not just Talma, but I think you said all the women, any of the women in her studio to pursue careers in composition. And it just seems slightly inconsistent with the fact that, of course, her own sister Lily had such a brilliant, if short-lived career. I just wondered if you could say a little more about that.
Absolutely. And of course, Nadia Boulanger had also pursued her own career as a composer. And had worked a lot with Raul Puno. They were composing an opera together at one time. Talma was unusual in that Boulanger encouraged her to pursue a career. For many of the women who studied the Conservatoire American, Boulanger found that they fell into sort of three different camps. There were women who attended who were already professional musicians and teachers in the United States. She felt that those would be better served by taking harmony and solfege classes and improving their ability to teach their own students those basic techniques. There were students who were not quite at a professional level. These students, she usually tried to send packing as early as she could during the course of the summer. Then there were students who wanted to be professional composers. And for the most part, Boulanger felt that either they had started their training too late or that they simply did not have the talent for the career. Usually she would take these women aside and tell them that the best way for them to contribute to the musical life of the world was to go home, marry, and have sons who could then be trained from a young age to be the composers of the next generation. This does seem incredibly sexist. But I think a lot of this stems from Boulanger's very devout Catholicism, in which she felt that a woman's place was always at home with children, and that the most important role a woman could have was to raise a child. While she herself obviously did not marry, she did consider adopting several times because she wanted to be a mother. So there is within her this own conflict between career and church and children. And for the most part, unless she found a student who was willing to give up the idea of a family and children, then she would not encourage those students to continue. Talma, of course, really modeled herself after Boulanger in many ways, not just career-wise, but she adopted her way of speaking. Talma, whose English was perfectly fluent and spoken without a trace of an accent, would begin her lessons by speaking in Boulanger's French accented English. She dressed like Boulanger. Of course, Boulanger was her godmother when she converted to Catholicism, and she modeled herself on Boulanger in all sorts of ways. If you look at photographs of the two of them in class together at Fontainebleau, you can see that Talma is wearing the same clothes, she has her hair done the same way, she wears her religious jewelry the same way. So yeah, it is an interesting conundrum that Boulanger would take a few students and say, okay, you have the talent, you have the basics, I will let you continue. As opposed to the many more students that she felt did not have the foundations or were starting too late, and in her mind would be better off, you know, giving birth to composers rather than being composers. Other questions? Jesse?
So at the beginning of your lecture, you put up a slide that listed the many male composers that Boulanger taught. And I'm wondering about the relationship that Talma had with those composers that she knew.
Yes, that's a great question, because it's an interesting relationship. Here are the women who made their names known as Boulanger students, and here are the men. Talma was a peer of Aaron Copland and Virgil Thompson. She was about in their same age, their age group. And while they certainly all knew each other from their study at Fontainebleau, they did not tend to run in the same circles. Joseph Strauss has talked about the myth of serial tyranny and the myth of the divide between the tonal composers and the serial composers in the 20th century, and how this divide was not as great or as schismatic as has been previously thought. Nonetheless, there was kind of a sense that there were two groups. There were French-trained American composers who worked primarily in a tonal language, like Copland and Thompson. And then we had German-trained American composers who went on to work in serialism, Piston, Babbitt, and Schumann. So Talma kind of found herself in between these groups. She was female, she had trained in France, but yet she ended up working in serialism starting in the 1950s. And used that through the rest of her career. So there was that sort of divide where she was had a foot on each side a little bit. There is a lot of correspondence between Erin Copeland and Virgil Thompson, writing back and forth to one another, saying, well, you know, Louise is on this board with us. You know, she's in the American Composers League and this and that. Maybe we should have her over for dinner or a party. And then the other one would sort of say, well, if you think we have to. So I think in a lot of cases, her gender also singled her out. While there were other women composing successfully during this period, Marion Bauer, Marion Gideon, with whom Talma was at least acquaintances, the coterie of composers in charge in New York tended to be male. I also think that Talma's sexuality played into this. Howard Pollack has written about the gay male composers in New York at the time, and while Talma engaged in several relationships with women, she was never out about her sexuality the way Copeland and Thompson were. So the idea of inviting not only a woman who's got a foot in both camps compositionally, but also someone with whom they were not quite sure about whether they wanted to include in a gay circle, even though she was female, was also problematic. So she was sort of pushed out of these groups and for several reasons. So she did have, you know, polite relationships with these men, but they were not particularly encouraging of her work. I'll say that as well. Erin Copeland was always putting her off, saying, oh, I'll be happy to look at your score next week, next month, when I get back from Europe, after I'm dead, some other time. There were other composers with whom she was very close. Jean Lamontagne was one of her good friends. He studied with Boulanger, and they were very close. She became good friends with Lucas Foss, who was not really in the Boulanger orbit, but was also in the Boston School of Composers, or the Stravinsky School, that Talma was considered to be part of, along with Harold Shapiro and some others. So it was kind of a mixed bag for her. I think she never felt secure in approaching some of her colleagues from Fontainebleau, who had become big figures in contemporary music in New York, because she was not sure of the response she would get. It was always sort of a, do we have to invite Louise? Can't we just have Walter and Milton over and, you know, play bridge and drink scotch? She would have been happy to play bridge and drink scotch, but those social groups tended to be same-sex groups in a lot of ways. Other questions? Anything else? Well, I do want to thank our performers again. These are the world premieres of these two songs today. They had been performed privately before, but their performance history from the time they were written is unknown. It doesn't look like they were performed. So this is the first public performance of these. I hope not the last. Talma's early songs are really quite beautiful. They exist in fair copy here at the Library of Congress. They're very accessible. And they're lovely works that I think are fascinating, especially in the context of Talma's early life. So thank you again to Liz and Dave.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.